Barbara, your second. All those in favor? Carried. And then we have that we resolve into committee of the whole, resolve the council recess the special council meeting at 4:04. And then to the committee of the whole meeting to allow full discussion regarding the Watson and Associates presentation of development charging impact. And then part of that to resolution. Separate, okay, so let's move that. Barbara? Jim, you'll move that?
I'm sorry, I'm trying to get this down thing going.
John, you move that?
Yeah.
Okay. So Jim, we're just resolving into committee of the whole. Any discussion on that? All those in favor? Carried. Appointment of chair, be resolved that committee appoint. John?
Mayor Clausen.
Okay, anyone like to second that? Barbara?
Yep.
And discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Presentation of development charges impact, presentation by Andrew Grunda. Am I pronouncing that correctly?
Yes.
Okay. Principal of Watson and Associates Economies Limited, be resolved that committee recommends to council that the presentation on development charges impact be received for information, so move and second that at this point. Barbara? And Don, thank you. And discussion is all yours, sir. And so we interrupt.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Today I'm also joined by Rick Kirk of Triton as well to answer questions related to the program, to provide me with some assistance in that respect in terms of his existing project. I just wanted to sort of put some context to the capital needs that underlie the calculations that you'll see later and associated policies. To put the development charges in proper context is that it is a mechanism that councils have available to it to recover growth-related costs of capital for new development, whether that be residential development or non-residential industrial, commercial, institutional development that may occur. And so this is a mechanism that allows municipalities to recover an increase in need for service or expansion of capacity that is attributable to that development. To help augment their capital funding so that existing ratepayers are not paying for those increases for presumably services they already have sufficient levels of service. And so the development charge, what it identifies is that we have to look at what those costs of service can be by type, and it recognizes that some of those costs are already going to be recovered directly from applicants as conditions of their development, which is commonly referred to as local services under the Act. And that is a policy that has come before council to help inform those differentiations in cost. And so when we look at the methodology that's prescribed under the Act, this illustration just summarizes the steps that have to be considered, and you'll see those in more detail in the capital need sheet to follow. And so it commences by looking at the anticipated development in the municipality. And so I think that's an important point, is that the intent of this DC and undertaking it at this time, even though the municipality has recently completed the study in 2015, was the feeling that there was higher than anticipated growth expected in the township than what had been previously provided for in the 2015 study. And to put that into some perspective, the 20-year growth outlook that was identified in the 2015 study had assumed a growth of an additional 665 residential units over the 20-year period, where this growth forecast is almost experiencing a doubling, or more than a doubling of that, or roughly over 1,400 units, predominantly within Dundalk on urban services. And so that is fundamentally changing the outlook of growth, therefore requiring the municipality to revisit its development charge study at this time, as opposed to waiting until your five-year review, which would have taken place in 2020.
Chair, if you could just recap, we originally anticipated in the next 5 to 10 years an additional 700 homes, 700 to 800 homes. Now we're talking about doubling that over what time frame?
That's over the 20 years.
20 years, thank you.
And so again, because particularly because we're my understanding that was that with that increasing growth, the DC needs to be revisited to make sure that they're accurately including all of those capital needs. And so that development then sets the course for then understanding or determining what the DC should be. And as we progress down from that anticipated development, we noted that there are certain services under the Act that even if they are growth-related, cannot be considered for inclusion in a bylaw. Those are services such as general administrative services of the municipality, solid waste management in the terms of it's related to incineration or landfill. And that's recently changed. It used to be all solid waste, but now we can include diversion, which we couldn't previously. It also doesn't allow us to include costs related to acquisition of parks, because you can receive acquisition of parkland costs in the Planning Act, and so you can't augment that through DC. Also with respect to cultural facilities, right? So we can include services related to libraries, but not cultural facilities, which would typically take the form of things like performing arts centers, art galleries, things of that nature. Also tourism facilities, so to the extent that we're to have convention centers, information, things of that nature. Again, the Act precludes us from using development charges for the purpose of recovering the stuff.
Okay,
that's
go ahead.
Actually, to that point, I'd just like some clarification. You're saying that the library can be included in development charges, but a community facility that might have a theater, like an auditorium or a place to hold weddings, would not be covered under development charges.
So they typically, when we look at recreation facilities, are a service that can be included. And so typically, we would see things like community centers being permissible inclusion, but to the extent that they're exclusively used for cultural purposes, like a performing arts center, they wouldn't be.
What's the ratio?
I'm sorry?
How do you figure out what the ratio is?
I think it more likely relates to the dominant use in a lot of cases.
50% theater use or more?
Yeah, like I think if it's exclusively going to be used for cultural services, then I think it would prevent you from including it. If it's joint use, right, then you might look at the underlying usage of the facility to determine what share of that may be eligible. So if it's a joint performing arts center, recreation, community center, you might look at the square footage of the construction or the expansion. Right? And then, even though we're identifying the cost, as you'll see as we move through this process, we then need to determine what share of that cost can we attribute to new development.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so a lot of times when we're talking about facilities, mostly that's reflecting, you know, an increase in gross floor area, right, or expansion, or a new project that we're replacing something else,
mm-hmm.
as an example. And so again, it may not necessarily preclude it from an inclusion in the analysis, but then do the deduction of how we determine what share of it may be attributable to a recreational facility, we might be using that kind of information, like the amount of usage or footage.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you.
The other area of ineligible services to note is hospitals. Right? So to the extent that municipalities have to, are making capital contributions towards hospitals, we cannot recover those costs from developers.
So if I may, is there a particular slide that we're supposed to be looking at that mentions that?
No, this is just summarized in the methodology, so the ineligible
okay.
services between development, anticipated development, and estimated use of services.
Because I hadn't heard the word hospital used before. Thank you.
So, that
is. Sorry, could you just repeat what you said about hospitals?
Sure. So, to the extent that council would have to make capital contributions towards a hospital, then that capital.
Or chooses to.
Chooses to, need to, right? Through your capital programs, your capital budget.
It could be a choice, not a need, right?
Right.
Okay, you're good. Go ahead.
And so, again, maybe put it in context. So, what we're trying to determine here is from your capital budget. Right? We know that there are some projects that are simply going to be rehabilitation replacement capital. So we know that those would be capital costs that would be triggered by existing residents, irrespective of the development or not. Right? And so typically those costs don't need to in this context is identify where there's an increase in capital need related to that development, right? And so if, for example, we said the municipality is going to contribution to a new hospital facility, and that hospital facility was, your contribution was going to provide capital that would provide service to account for both existing and growth in the larger community for the next 20 years, then it could be considered that part of your contribution was for future needs of development as opposed to as well as existing. And so what the Act prevents from doing is saying that a portion of that capital contribution towards the hospital that would be growth-related, it could not be included in this calculation because the Act does not allow us to include hospital services as an eligible capital cost.
Bottom line, can't include it.
Through the chair, to that point, would that include a medical services doctor's office?
Right, and so that's where you'll see in the slide there's been an inclusion of a medical services building.
Yes.
So again, to the extent that there's a capital requirement of the municipality to fund that or a portion thereof,
yes,
that we think is providing growth, and it's defined as a hospital,
right,
then we can include. So that's why we see it included in the provision here now, but not, it was a broader hospital requirement.
Right. Thank you.
So having then determined what are the eligible services, we must identify the increase in need for those services, again, on a service-by-service basis. You'll see that one of the requirements in estimating that need is that there's an expression of counsel that those needs will be met. So that in part was the purpose of the presentation that brought forward to council last time, was to identify that with the anticipated development that there would be increases in capital needs, and that while those needs may change as you move through your budget process, there's a general need for an increase in service that's required. The other sources that we have to rely on in that is your previous DC background study, your capital budgets and forecasts,